So even though we paid a little bit of a penalty to make isocitrate, when we go to make alpha-ketoglutarate, we have a really nice high negative delta G. So we know this is a dehydrogenase reaction. So we know it's going to be a redox reaction. And so one of the things we need for this reaction is we need our NAD+. So that one. So we need that. And at the same time, we're going to do a decarboxylation reaction. So the combination of decarboxylating it and hydrogen or converting the NAD plus to the NADH, both of those two is what's helping drive that negative delta G. And our entropy is one of the big things that's going up. So you've taken a 6-carbon component now and split it into a 5 and a 1. So the T delta S portion of that delta G reaction is going to be pretty big. That entropy went up when you did the 6 to 5 plus 1. So there's our first NADH producing step. And we'll throw a little regulation in there. What do you think? You got it. Okay, so we did our isocitrate dehydrogenase, produced an NADH and a carbon dioxide, and now we've got alpha-ketoglutarate. So we're going to go alpha-ketoglutarate to succinyl-CoA. So again, a really nice high negative delta G. It's our second decarboxylation reaction, but it is very similar to that pyruvate dehydrogenase complex that we used outside of the TCA site. So in that one, we produced the carbon dioxide, and we consumed a coenzyme A for that one. And so now we need to convert our succinyl-CoA to succinate. So it's a pretty simple reaction. We're just going to get rid of our coenzyme A on the end of that. And on the scale of the ones we've seen so far, it is relatively low. But it is relatively low because we've coupled it to the formation of a GTP. So, is that a substrate level phosphorylation?
Pretend it was GTP, GDP.
sorry, ADP to ATP. Pretend it was that. Because when we do substrate level phosphorylation, where is that phosphate supposed to be coming from?
From the ATP or ADP?
From the substrate.
From the substrate. So this substrate is not phosphorylated. So it's grabbing it from the solution, using the energy to produce a GTP. But isn't that phosphate's not coming from the substrate? Because a lot of times when you're driving the substrate level phosphorylations, the phosphate is on the substrate, and so by breaking that bond, you get enough energy to convert ADP into ATP. But this is producing a GTP where you're just sucking up phosphate from solution, which is a little unusual. It's typically doesn't happen. But that's why the delta G for this reaction is so low. We've driven the synthesis of a GTP, which is 36 kcals per mole. Oh, I just contradicted myself. We just ignore that. Just contradicted myself. Okay, so when we do the next one, we're going to go from succinate to fumarate. So we need to generate a double bond in there. And so our delta G is actually zero for the very first time. We don't typically see a zero. So fumarate is going to be our four carbon unit. It's got a double bond between carbon number 2 and carbon number 3. And we're getting ready to do a hydration reaction. So malate and fumarate are very similar, structurally similar. One's got a double bond, one's got an OH group. So they still are four carbon units. So you can do a little feedback right there, a little malate fumarate feedback. So this reaction is the fumarase reaction. And so when we start with the double bond of fumarate, and generate the alcohol malate. So malate has the alcohol, and it's a symmetrical molecule. So there's no Markovnikov's rule here because both of them have the same number of hydrogens. And so when you add water across that double bond, you'll lose your double bond. You get OH group on one side, H on the other side. So since this is symmetrical, it doesn't matter where that OH group goes. So you can write the OH group up here, or you can make the OH group down there, but it's just a symmetrical molecule. So our delta G is, negative 3.8 kilojoules per mole. Not too bad. So we are malate, and now we need to convert malate to oxaloacetate for our very last step. So our malate dehydrogenase, we're going to be converting malate to oxaloacetate in the process of producing NADH. So we have our alcohol that was on carbon number 2 of the malate here becomes the ketone in oxaloacetate. So again, how do we deal with that? So what's the next reaction? What's the enzyme for the next reaction?
Citrate
synthase.
Oh, which is so like starting again.
It's starting all over again. So this is, it truly is a cyclic reaction. It really does get dragged along by the next one, citrate all over again, and just sits. And anytime you see the TCA cycle, it's always written with a bunch of little arrows around in a circle. So this high negative delta G will not continue if that citrate synthase enzyme stops working. This reaction won't happen. That oxaloacetate won't get pulled through to the next reaction. And I think the citrate synthase is like negative 31 or something. So really high negative delta G and highly regulated. So not only will you not worry about wasting your energy, you're not even going to do the previous reaction either. Okay, so each turn of the cycle, so that means starting with one acetyl-CoA, so one 2-carbon unit, we're going to get 3 NADHs, an FADH2, a GTP, and 2 carbon dioxides. So that's incredibly efficient. It's only a 2-carbon unit. And that's why way back at the beginning of the semester, I was like, yeah, people get like really obsessive about ATP, but really acetyl-CoA is way, way, way more important. Like, yeah, who cares? ATP's coming and going too fast. Acetyl-CoA, now I can do something with it. And in the process, we generate lots of different intermediates. We produce oxaloacetate, malate, and fumarate. And so amino acid side chains can feed into the TCA cycle and generate ATP, but they can also be drawn back out if you need to synthesize amino acids. So we've got 4 different oxidation steps. They're dehydrogenation steps in your NADH and your FAD. 1, ATP is made by substrate level phosphorylation, technically phosphorylated succinyl-CoA. And we need to generate our carbon dioxide and produce ATP only later on. And we have a link now. When we were doing the gluconeogenesis, we had malate and oxaloacetate as part of our bypass 1. So now we see a connection between acetyl-CoA and glycolysis, gluconeogenesis, all interconnected. So if we look at what we can make from them, if we start with alpha-ketoglutarate, so the second reaction on that side. So if we start with alpha-ketoglutarate, we can make glutamate. And what can I make from glutamate?
Amino acids.
I can make proteins, right? So glutamate is an amino acid. I can go and synthesize proteins from it. Glutamate and glutamine are two really, really important amino acids. And if we end up doing the urea cycle, you'll see how important those two amino acids are. So oxaloacetate, what can we do with oxaloacetate? We could turn it to pyruvate, and we could use pyruvate, we could go do gluconeogenesis with it, right? So we can also use it as a source of synthesizing an amino acid, and oxaloacetate and aspartate are linked together. And then if we're aspartate, we can go make proteins. So citrate is a 6-carbon unit, but we can do an enzymatic reaction that takes our citrate and chops off the acetyl-CoA. So it's almost like the opposite of the first reaction. It's almost like the opposite of citrate synthesis. So when I do that reaction, I produce acetyl-CoA, and then I can go do fat synthesis of fatty acids. So why would you do that?
It's pretty sure it's called citrate lyase, if I remember correctly. I'll look it up.
So why, that seems like so counterintuitive.
So what would be the purpose of that one?
You just put it on. Why are you taking it back off again? Exactly. So here's the quick from producing NADH and ATP and GTP from the quick energy to the long-term storage. This one, if you stop here and go through the TCA cycle, you'll produce all the quick energy you need, NADH, FADH2, ATP. But at some point, you're going to go, don't need that anymore. You're sitting on the couch. So let's go back to the 2-carbon component, and then we'll use that 2-carbon component when we do fatty acid synthesis. Lipogenesis will be our next topic. So we're going to be doing that conversion. And so succinyl-CoA at that 6 o'clock position can be used to go and synthesize the heme portion of hemoglobin. Well, it seems like you're throwing hydrogens on, moving OH groups around, creating double bonds, and taking them back off again. Really, it's not an expended source of energy, and it actually is pretty amazingly efficient. So not only do you still generate a 4-carbon unit, you still get to produce all those ATP. And again, biochemists like to go, wherever you see acetyl-CoA, go convert everything to ATP, and let's count it up. I know they love to do that. So we get... So we get 8 ATP from glycolysis. Here's our little tally. We get 6 ATP from our pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. We get 24 from the TCA cycle. And depending on whether you put GTP in there or not, some people say 36, some people say 38. The most important thing is by the time you're done, we've been able to harness about 47% of the theoretical kilojoule value for a molecule of glucose, which in general is not bad. So pyruvate carboxylase. So pyruvate carboxylase does this reaction. So it actually puts on a carbon dioxide and generates oxaloacetate. We did a little bit of that when we did bypass one for that reaction. So this enzyme actually is part of the regulation for the TCA only because of our coenzyme A component. So why are we going to do that one? Why are we going to activate that one?
Is that activating the gluconeogenesis?
That is part of what it does. Yes, because what that says is there is an awful lot of acetyl-CoA around. Go make what you need. So go take this, synthesize oxaloacetate. You can go and synthesize glucose if you need to. The other thing it does is it says that there's an awful lot of acetyl-CoA around, so make more oxaloacetate so you can combine with more acetyl-CoA to make more citrate and go through that way. So it's a way of reducing the amount of acetyl-CoA. So I'm sure on the other side, it's also activating lipogenesis. So up above, we have our pyruvate dehydrogenase up there. So we've got negative on our acetyl-CoA and NADH and ATP, all those mean too much, don't make more. Let's see. Oh yeah, good, yeah, that's good. So here's our acetyl-CoA. There's our pyruvate carboxylase and our pyruvate dehydrogenase. That's the complex one. Okay, good. All right, so now we've got our citrate. So we need to stop the production of citrate if we've got too much succinyl-CoA, too much citrate, too much NADH, too much ATP. All of those mean store it, don't overwhelm the TCA cycle, stop the production of citrate. Go let acetyl-CoA build up and go make fatty acids with the acetyl-CoA. So isocitrate dehydrogenase inhibited by those two and stimulated by their opposites. A little feedback inhibition for succinyl-CoA to the alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase. Oops. Okay, we'll stop with that one today. So we just have a little teeny bit left to finish, and then we're going to start lipogenesis and lipolysis. And our book shoves them both into the same chapter. Typically, I try to separate them a little bit more than that, but I'm just going to go with it and see if we can mesh them together pretty well.